it was interesting. It became national for a while, not just wanted to take your company public. And so I said, there were all kinds of companies that were clearly emerging, Facebook, LinkedIn, Zynga, and they're all talking about it. I don't know if anyone wanted to go public. So there was an enormous amount of angst in the venture community. And, you know, it's the IPO we get is, you know, literally. The second thing that happened is you can take money out of companies and manage the team and they start taking companies out of money and they emerge in the secondary markets. And it used to be that the enormous, typically compensation structures in Silicon Valley are tier towards equity. And if you can't sell equity to an IPO, it's a huge incentive to, you know, for management to want to take the company public. When the secondary market mitigated that incentive by allowing some pretty substantial sales pre-transaction, it took the edge off too. So there was just nothing in public for a while, and then combined that with probably the worst markets. Stock market.
Yeah, that's 1929. Yeah. Tell me about that. You got to tell me about this to go public, but we've got to build
this up. Yeah, so it was kind of fun. We've been working with the board. Should we take the company public or not? We finally decided we'd do it. We held our bake offs in August of 2008, and finally got together with the board and decided which bank we're going to go with on a Thursday. We told the six lead men, six contenders to be lead back on Friday, who got it and who didn't. Even on the news that they did get the lead at Open Table, declared bankruptcy on Saturday, Merrill Lynch, who did get the lead, traded to Bank of America on Sunday. Our business falls apart with the economic meltdown over the weekend, and we work on Monday morning. So it was an inauspicious beginning.
So, why did you guys get the look in the first place? I mean, nobody was supposed to time. What was the rationale? I mean, everything, you know, looking at as well.
Yeah, no, I mean, the company that I joined was almost 10 years old. So in venture terms, that's prehistoric. The second thing is it was a restaurant reservation business and it wasn't obvious what company would acquire the kind of value we bought the company Meredith. So, you know, typically acquirers are strategic acquirers. There aren't a lot of concepts in the restaurant business that you know, we're in a position to pay the locals that open if we talk about table. We thought an IPO was the primary way towards
So you were the guys on Valley of Ideas. Tell me about what's happened since then. I mean, now it's fashionable, or it's still less than fashionable.
Well, you know, the bankers are the lead up to the IPO shows the charts of the market, the IPO window opening and closing over time. And one of the things that happens when it opens is that typically the first few companies out are really quality companies. They've been waiting, they're ready to go, building the test for tests like Open Table. And then as the window opens, you know, some really good companies continue to go in, but then the floodgates typically open. And typically as happened in the past cycle is the market performance of that second wave of companies has not always been fantastic. So one of the strategies at Open Table was trying to get out in front of that wave.
So we were talking a little bit earlier about that. They've taken a ton of fees, there's a variety of issues they face, but you're very bullish on them. They might have appeared to be in that second wave,
right?
Not as good
numbers. Right. No, I mean, I think what these have, what Andrew and the management team and the Lightbank folks have accomplished is just stunning in terms of business execution and growth. We spent, I think, over the table 13, 14 years on down at 20,000 restaurants. Guys have hundreds of thousands of merchants worldwide in just a few years. So, you know, the pace at which they grew that business, and the fact they actually had to do it, you know, store by store, feet on the street, banging on doors is pretty amazing. That's, you know, I think the biggest challenge they had is that they were so motivated to go public, they might have had a premature. You grow faster than any company has ever grown, and you do it globally. It's, it's a degree of complexity, and so they took that high degree of complexity and did it in a relatively early transaction. I'm very bullish on drawing.
So what do you see happening? I mean, they're like the poster child for why people should invest in tech. Well, they've been the poster child, I should say.
Yeah. So there was enormous injury. Once people saw the success of the fun on social, there was enormous injury in a ton of market fun. And I mean, we had a product that opened people, as did, Yelp, and, literally hundreds and hundreds of startups. Well, it turns out there's huge scale advantages in this market, and virtually all that competitive noise has gone away. It is now to a two company race again,
social
or money. And they do, there is a class of merchants. This is a very powerful product. And, when you look at the merchant has, everyone has strong merchant renewal rates. They can fill out your business. There's a value for that.
So, just so the audience knows, this firm is in Facebook right now, so we can not talk about that. I tried to make it, we do that many times. You said that. But you guys are obviously very positive on tech stocks. Mark Andreessen's been talking about that repeatedly over the years. Wall Street's not agreeing right now. What's your message to Wall Street? How do you explain this going on?
I mean, we see this as an unparalleled opportunity for growth of technology companies. If you compare Mark has a piece of Mark Andreessen, which Mark has a piece of software is for the world. You compare what the world looks like now versus the first bubble in 1999, the addressable market has just exploded. Within a few years, there are going to be something like 5 million people walking around with mobile computers. That's a couple order of magnitude bigger than an addressable market. The cost of service, the cost of getting products to market has plummeted down due to Moore's Law, due to better programming. So you get an enormous global market that if you can get product market fit, there is virtually no governor on how fast the business can grow. I mean, if Google Analytics work, right? Facebook is an impressive company. I have a portfolio company, Neuralink, we're on Pinterest, and it's publicly reputed to be the fastest growing internet company ever. And so when you get product market fit, things can go so big, so fast, and value can be created in all the companies, or we think we're
value. So, you're in New York right now. We have public market investors watching this thing, of course, this is going to be saying this. Yeah. Private investor.
Yeah.
What's your message to them right now?
We believe that tech stocks are trading at historic lows relative to the broad market index. There are incredibly valuable franchises being developed every day. Not every company, not every tech company is a big company. But when you look at the basket of strong
companies,
I'll respect it, but in addition to the DM, but I know a lot of people. In our portfolio, Foursquare is a new work. We think that's a great company. I mentioned Pinterest. Fab, Jason was here on stage last night.
Public stocks right now. You have gone public.
Oh, okay. No, I think we're going to be selfish open table. It's a phenomenal company that is now significantly undervalued by the market. It has a vicious network effect in the restaurant business, and no one has begun to assail it. And its multiples are down by about two-thirds from where they were.
Just walk me through this a little bit more. What do you think a public investor should be looking for right now? What sort of multiple is there to you?
Yeah, I think multiples are really specific by the company and the index, but the earnings potential, companies that are providing consistent and significant growth behind their earnings, deserve a premium valuation. And it's the growth and the consistency. And if you can have those with an attractive margin structure,
public investors have heard this for, they've heard you guys say this, they're like, yeah, whatever, I'm short Facebook, I'm short anybody I can. But, do they just not care? Do they not really do? What do you mean? Do you know what they're
doing? No, in a highlight, actually, it's interesting. I've had conversations with what I consider some of the smarter public market investors, and the philosophies of investing between what we're doing in addition to what they're doing are remarkable. Mark and Ben raised the fundamental thesis that about 15 companies every year create all the returns of the venture capital business. And so the goal of our firm is to try to be in as many of those 15 as we can. So we're stage agnostic. We go from seed and Instagram to seed to very late stage investments like Facebook or Airbnb. There are public market investors who have exactly the same philosophy, who have decade-long track records about performing the market, and they did that on essentially 10 or 15. They made big bets early on quality companies that, that grew and grew a lot of returns.
So who are further coming? I mean, you've been in this space for a long time. You're at eBay in 99. Like what do you see like the comparisons? I mean, it's just like the Amazons of tomorrow, like another company at the market right now.
I think Amazon's a phenomenal company, so that would be very pinnacle of what they're like. I think it's really quality. Maybe a handful of the companies are quality companies with the potential to be franchises in the Amazon neighborhood. I mean, Facebook, phenomenal company. Gameplay is phenomenal.
Got it. But you're saying also a ton of activity in the late stage market where you have investors, you know, like buying and selling stock on the secondary market before companies go public. Tell me a little bit more about that.
It's actually, we were very active in that when the firms first started. One of the most controversial investments we made was in Skype, which was people who bought out of eBay, out of partners from Silver Lake. Like, you know, that's not a venture investment. What are you doing? So we bought late stage stakes in Groupon, Zynga, Facebook, Airbnb. At some point, about a year ago, we came to the conclusion that that market opportunity was closing for a while. And essentially what's happening is the amount of capital chasing those deals exploded, and the types of people chasing those deals exploded. Increasingly, we found they're competing with mutual fund investors who are doing late-stage private deals. In an effort to get a jump on an IPO allocation, and we're high growth, high risk return investors. They are supposed to be public market, more conservative investors. If we're bidding at the same price for the same stock, one of us should be at the table. So we have backed out of that market class.
I mean, a lot of people are still saying that about Facebook, but the secondary markets are called the growth opportunity on Facebook, and now it's like valued extremely highly for how much money it's making, how much work it has left to do. I mean, hasn't this just sort of the ability for public markets to see the benefits of private company and future growth?
That hasn't what?
What's that?
It hasn't what?
Just sort of secondary investments.
Oh, no, secondary investments. You know, I think what's secondary investments have been interesting. I think the ecosystem is trying to figure out how to balance the absolutely legitimate need of entrepreneurs and operators to achieve some form of liquidity as they're building a company and maintain incentives that the equity was really supposed to be there. I think it's a working process.
Where do you see that shaping up? I mean, you're in the middle of that. You missed some of those bets. It sounds like you're going earlier stage these days and you're away from that more.
Yeah, I mean, the core of our activity in the last year has been C2 B round. I personally have done mostly B rounds of really high growth super companies that we think they have great potential, but we're really pleased with the portfolio.
Well, just tell me a little bit more about that. Like, what has been increasing for what's the strategy? They started 3 years ago, they came out of nowhere, not nowhere, but they suddenly jumped into venture investing, and now they're competing hard with every other top VC core for you.
Yeah, no, I mean, it is interesting. I think people are more committed. I mean, the company's not that. They did a phenomenal job positioning the firm. And when their core insight, when they founded Zen Labs Cloud, became Opsware, was that when you weren't going to a venture capitalist, you typically got about 1/12 of the time that that venture capitalist wasn't spent looking at new investments. You've got that venture capitalist Rolodex, that venture capitalist network. And so, they created a new round of the benchmark for providing enormous value as an individual. But they were wondering if there was a model that would give them more. So they tried to start a venture firm that they wanted when they were founded. So a couple of things was every investment professional in the firm is a successful operator or a successful entrepreneur. Because we think that person is more valuable than an entrepreneur trying to build a company. They have, instead of just paying out the fees to in terms of salary, they reinvest the fees in a set of core services designed to help the entrepreneurs grow their business. Tech recruiting, engineering, design talent, core market development, marketing CR. Now, there are 55 people at the firm now, and only 6 are investors. The majority of 49 are working directly with their portfolio companies, and that makes a difference. Airbnb, Mark is very active in that field. We have a number of things on the
future. And then you guys recently announced that you're going to be donating half of the profits from your investment activities to charity, which was, I talked to some investors and they're like, that's what you're saying.
DM's expensive, the art stuff. No, I mean,
it's undermining those guys' ability to get, make money, right? I mean, there's definitely some little better than the
We did we were at an offsite and we had a discussion and we're all passionate about philanthropy. We're all in a position, if you hire people who are successful operators or entrepreneurs, you're in a position where you start thinking, there's three places your money goes. And your friends, the government, or charity. So we are at the point now where we'd rather have it be giving philanthropic pursuits. We would be ecstatic if others would follow the
example. Do you agree with people who want to do that?
Everyone can make their own choice. We're going to place their choice.
Got it. So you're on the board of Pinterest, which we started up with funding yesterday that we're about to close. Airbnb. What is it that you look for now? I mean, you're focused on e-commerce, and you're spending a ton of time in New York. Tell me about what's changed. Why are you there so much?
Yeah.
What's going on?
Yeah. So first, in terms of companies, you're looking for one of those companies that can be one of the 15 that create all the value each year. Companies that have potentially core franchises in their market. So, when I first saw Airbnb, it reminded me more of eBay. Pinterest, when the founders came in and showed us, how hard they worked to achieve product market fit and the, straight up nature of the line of both users and engagements, they clearly had hit something special. Airbnb is the fastest e-commerce, growing pace e-commerce company I have ever encountered. Jason and Bradford have done it. So you look for things that are just, how to be ordinary, over the top.
Let's back up a little bit. How do you, so many things in right now, we're talking about Facebook newsfeed, the social readers, the video apps. Facebook just plugs you in, you hit your right change, you grow, they take it away.
I've noticed the phenomenon now. We have to be really careful about Facebook giving, Facebook and taking it away. So there are businesses that innovation happening in the